Big changes to Australia's COVID rules today. International travel back on for the fully vaxxed, and New South Wales once again with the regions open to the city.
For more, Premier Dominic Perrottet joins us now from Sydney Airport. Premier, it is the place to be this morning, isn't it?
It is, Ali. It's very exciting here. Many people will be able to now fly into Sydney, New South Wales, and not have to hotel quarantine, and also travel to the regional New South Wales. So we'll have many people being reunited with their families. So it's a great day for our state.
There are lovely scenes, actually. As you say, regional travel has the green light, but some mayors are still a little bit concerned about the vax rate still not being high enough. Do you share those concerns, particularly in northern parts of New South Wales?
Oh, I don't, Carl. I know there's going to be challenges along the way, but ultimately we delayed our regional travel for 2 weeks just to get those vax rates up. In the main, we have a double dose rate across regional New South Wales of above 80%. In some places, it's above 90%. But we have to open up. We've got to open up safely, and we think we've struck the right balance here.
There's been a bit of talk over the weekend and today, as you know, about when unvaccinated people will get their freedoms. Are you on board with waiting until the state hits 95%, or are you still sticking with December 1?
Ali, we're looking at that. We've got a cabinet meeting this week to go through those further details. We've set a roadmap to provide clarity and certainty for people. But we want to drive that vax rate up as high as we can to around 95%. And ultimately, if there are also opportunities to bring forward some of those relaxing of restrictions, we'll do that as well, because the vaccination rates in our state have been significant. It's incredibly pleasing to see the efforts that everyone's made, and that's really meant we can open up as quickly as possible, and today is a very important milestone. But we've said when we can move things forward, we will, but ultimately as well, we want to have as many people across the state the opportunity to get vaccinated, because that's the key to opening up safely. There's going to be challenges that come our way as we move forward the next 6 months, the next 12 months. But I'm very confident we've got the balance right here. We might make mistakes from time to time, but ultimately I think we're in a very good position.
So you don't think it's going to be a drama reaching 95%? I mean, that is a huge number of people vaccinated.
Yeah, well, look, it's a challenge, but I think it's a great goal to shoot for. And our health teams think that that's achievable. When you look at where we sit today, I mean, I remember going back into some of these meetings, Ali, months ago, that we were thinking here in our state that, you know, 80% would be a great goal to achieve. Mm-hmm. To be in a position now where we're coming very close to 95% is an incredible effort from everyone across the state. And that means that we can open up safely. And I think the decision today in relation to people being able to come into Sydney, come into Australia and not have to quarantine in hotels is going to be a great thing, not just for New South Wales, but for the country. And Carl spoke about the scenes at the airport. I think there's a lot of excited people as we start today the journey to rejoining the world.
You've got issues, I guess, when tourism is fully opened up to overseas, but also a more pressing issue is staff for hospitality in those regional areas in ag. Even just getting to places like Byron Bay and finding cleaners is incredibly difficult. What are you going to do about that?
Well, Carl, we're working very closely with the federal government. You're right. I mean, this is a significant challenge. We faced this last year as well when we opened up in our state. And we want to get as much skilled labour as we can. It's a much better issue to have than a higher unemployment rate. So it's good to see that. I'd prefer to have shortages than more people out of work. But particularly the areas that you've said, hospitality, agriculture. I know our Deputy Premier here has worked very closely with the federal government to bring in as many people for the agricultural sector as we can, because, you know, they've gone through a very difficult time here in our state off the back of bushfires and drought. We've now got a, you know, bumper harvest season. We want to make sure people are there to be able to provide the labour that's necessary. But hospitality as well, out and about in town, one of the biggest issues they're finding is their trade's up 200%, but their labour and the staff's down 50%. So it's a real challenge for us, and that's why I think making the decision we made in relation to scrapping hotel quarantine for fully vaccinated paves the pathway going forward, where, yes, we're focused on returning Australians, but we'll get to tourism and we'll get to skilled labour as quickly as possible.
So do you have a date for that? So at the moment you have to be an Australian resident returning home. When are you looking at international students and tourists being able to visit?
Well, Ali, we don't control the borders, but I would like to see that this year. And I think there's been some good statements by coming out of the federal government, by the Prime Minister, about bringing back tourism and moving past simply returning Australians. And we've already seen, based on the announcement we made coming into effect today, that Qantas has brought on a number of extra flights. They're bringing back staff, around 11,000 staff who have been stood down for the last 18 months. So I think this will move quickly, and that's a really positive thing. So as long as the federal government can prove that vaccination status for non-Australians wanting to come into Sydney, then we'll work very closely with them. But I'd like to see tourism, more international students back, and bringing that labour back into New South Wales as quickly as possible.
All right, you've got to take the good with the bad when you're Premier. In just over an hour, Gladys Berejiklian is back in the hot seat at the corruption inquiry. You got a mention last week, you must have enjoyed that. What's a bit of pork barrel in between friends, huh?
Well, look, Carl, I'm not going to give a running commentary on the ICAC, but ultimately we've got a great track record when it comes to investing right across the state. I was out yesterday in Glebe. That's a seat that's represented by the Greens here in New South Wales. And look, I think ultimately you've got to run on your record when it comes to by-elections. But also, you know, when you're in these roles as Premier, as Treasurer, you're always going to have members from both sides of the political divide advocating for their seats. That's a positive thing. That's what strong representation is all about. And I think we've been in a very good position in our state to be able to invest record amounts in health, education, public transport, everywhere across New South Wales.
So no pork barrelling?
No, I believe that we continue to invest in every single seat right across our state, whether that's in regional New South Wales, whether that's in metropolitan Sydney. I think very proud of the
Hang on, Premier, hang on. So one man's investing is another pork barrelling. Is that what you're saying?
No, what I'm saying, Carl. What I'm saying, Carl, is that every area of New South Wales is getting great representation under this government, and we'll continue to get record investment
All right.
wherever you live.
Just finally, we note this morning in News Limited papers that you're making all the sandwiches for all of your kids. I mean, that is quite the thing. I mean, there's a couple of hundred sandwiches every day. Off. The burning question this morning is what you put on them.
Well, the worst thing about it, Carl, is they've all got different tastes. So this morning it was, you know, ham, cheese, tomato on one, peanut butter on the other. So I've got to kind of get this a bit more streamlined.
Oh, mate, you don't give them a choice, my friend. You know, you get what you get and you don't get upset.
I'll have a war on my hands. Anyway.
Oh, good stuff, Premier. With all girls in the house, I understand why you don't debate or argue with them. Just do what you're told.
Right. Good on you, Premier. Thank you. Okay, things are opening up here at home today. There are still plenty of communities extremely nervous, obviously, about all this, especially in regional New South Wales today. But it's going to be a big day, isn't it?
It's a great day. It's a day for celebration. More freedoms are coming back. If you're travelling internationally and you're an Australian citizen or resident, you're not having to go through those home quarantine arrangements. You can more easily now travel interstate between New South Wales and Victoria and within the ACT. And, of course, within our own states, we can move more freely now between the cities and the regions. So this is all good news for the economy. I was speaking to Alan Joyce yesterday and Jane Hardlicker from Virgin. Both were talking about how their ticket sales are going gangbusters. I mean, Qantas has sold more than 500,000 tickets in the last 2 weeks. Back in August, they were selling just 20,000 tickets over a two-week period. Same with Virgin. They're seeing very strong ticket sales. That's good news for our economy.
You've also said in the papers this morning you're concerned about China, especially given the potential impact on iron ore sales with the downturn there in the housing sectors. How much of a hit to the bottom line is that going to cause Australia?
Well, we did see the iron ore price, Carl, come down from over $200 earlier in the year to around $100, and it's stabilised there for now. But we've got a pretty conservative estimate of the iron ore price in our budget at $55 a tonne. So we've actually built in some buffers there. But what I was pointing out is that the Chinese economy is starting to slow for both cyclical and for structural reasons, and the housing sector, which is a large part of their economy, has seen a bit of a slowdown as well.